Welcome to the stream. Those of you who are just tuning in, we've got the North American League going on for us. It's going to be an exciting match. Shattered Demon already being picked up by Bulba, having seen how well it played out in the previous game, despite the Terrorblade ban actually coming through. I'm surprised he didn't pick up that Darkseer. I know Bulba loves him some Darkseer. Does ban out the Rikimaru and the Timbersaw, though, leaving quite a few good offlaners in the pool if Bulba wants to be picking one up for him right now. But after that axe in the previous game, I think he's more than comfortable with his hero pool and perhaps will be picking up something more valuable. Well, it will end up being the offlaner or perhaps the four position role in the Beastmaster being picked up this early on. And it was an instantaneous pick with Bulba wasting no time and even thinking about it. And just happens to be a very good pick against the Juggernaut and against the Lion as well to some extent. Lion doesn't do all that well in the lane against him. If he gets slowed up, he won't be able to catch up to try and get up that Impel, try and get up that Hex. That being said though, Lion is able to provide some good killing potential with the laning partner that is the Juggernaut. Beastmaster with the Roar, fairly good against the Juggernaut later on in the game where you need to have a disable that goes through the spin. And looks like that's exactly what he's going to be providing to this game. And I'm very few viewers tonight. I'm slightly surprised at this, but hopefully there will be going up as the night goes on. You know what they say, the night is still young. You never really know what they're going to be going for. Oh man, I feel so sick. I wonder how many streamers MSS has, how many views MSS has. Reserve time has been entered though for the dice. Well, actually Bulba ends up banning the Darkseer, so, you know, for good reason. It's one of those heroes that everyone can play. Basically, everyone knows how to play with a Darkseer on their team as well. And I've talked about this quite a bit, like I try to talk about this a couple of times every time I stream, that the North American Elite League is essentially a high-level pub. Yes, there are players who know each other, there are players who have played with each other a lot, but when you get to that level in pubs where you're sitting at about 6,000 plus MMR, you basically know everyone anyway. Especially in the North American scene where there's a lot fewer players who are in that high MMR range. Now with the Bounty Hunter and the Earthspirit bans coming through though, Radiant side having taken out the supports that they don't want to be dealing with, and Elder Titan and Rikimaru also having been banned out by one side or the other. A lot of the supports that are popular are out of the pool, so Revenge, we'll have to wait and see what they end up going for over here. Banning time right now though, and that might be a Faceless Void ban coming through, but instead it's a hero that serves a very similar purpose but synergizes much, much better with the Juggernaut. It is the Titan Hunter ban out and the immediate Faceless Void pickup from RWO, just as predicted. I'm on fire today, man. I mean, the predictions I'm making. Baby. Okay, that is something I cannot wait. Suddenly I'm a lot more hyped up. So we've got a Shadow Demon and a Kunkka. We know what this lane does. We've seen it time and time again. If this is in the mid lane, if it's a dual lane, that's ridiculous. Phoenix comes out. They're already two of the big. This is a very fast draft coming out of Bulba though. So two of the big boys really coming out. In terms of combinations, Faceless Void and Phoenix go hand in hand. Shadow Demon, Kunkka go Disruption, Torrent together. You throw out the Ghost Ship as well. That's basically a dead hero no matter what you do. Dire team back. Taking into account the Soul Catcher as well. This is definitely going to be a very fun game for Kunkka and not a very fun game for the Radiant side as the Naga Siren gets banned out, not wanting to fight up against the late game potential that the Naga does bring to you. You could all of a sudden the Juggernaut into that mid lane and make your Naga lane in the safe lane. A bit of a weak pick in my opinion, but of course Bulba prioritizing it more than some of the other heroes that we could think of. Now moving into his last pick over here, what did they go for? They do need a middle hero if this is going to be a support Kunkka. So Bulba needs to decide whether or not he wants to send this Kunkka into the mid lane, and he needs to predict whether or not what the hero for Radiant will be for their mid lane. So far, Storm Spirit isn't really looking all that bad. There isn't that much lockdown for him. Does very well against the Morphling. Does decently against the Beastmaster as well. So we could see a Storm Spirit pick coming through. So Bulma needs to keep that in mind when he's deciding what he wants to be playing up in that mid lane. Storm Spirit, of course, also just one of those heroes that can farm considerably more safely in the lane. Could go for a Queen of Pain for Bulba right now, because that does synergize pretty well with the Shadow Demon Klunkka support rotating through. Looks like RWO does think that it is going to be a support combination and not a middle lane Klunkka. And that's exactly what the case is going to be, as the Mirana has been picked up for the mid lane. Could be a roaming Mirana, Shadow Demon Mirana, of course. Great combination. It's like Bane Mirana, but, well, it's not better, but it's almost as good. In some ways, it is better. Better against people who are laning together, people who are coordinated enough to take off the nightmare that the Bane does provide. 5 seconds. That being said, though, it's still going to be a bit of a nightmare for them. Simply because Mirana, Shadow Demon, Klunkka, these are just skill shots that you can normally rely on prediction to, that you normally are forced to rely on prediction to have to set up those skill shots some one way or the other. But now with the Shadow Demon, the probably the best setup possible, the best setup imaginable for these heroes, this is going to be a very rough lane for whoever does end up going mid, even to some extent whoever goes off lane, and they're going to be very highly reliant on this Tinker to get off to a decent start, or if nothing else, the Juggernaut to get off to a decent start, so the Tinker can go out, farm some stacks, get some recovery farm going his way, which is really the important thing. That being said, the game will be underway shortly, and as far as whose draft I like better, I'm gonna go ahead, I'm gonna call it Revenge. They look pretty goddamn solid right now. The Radiant side just seem a little bit shaky. They've been playing this draft as a reaction-based draft after the Phoenix and the Faces Void did come through. They just seem very, very wary about what they can be going for, and for good reason. So RWO picking up that Phoenix, Benjazz on the Juggernaut, Ryu on the Tinker, Fluff and Stuff on the, I wonder what team tag that is, ENS, I don't really know. Fluff and Stuff on the line, and finally on the top lane we do have Ryu setting up that Faces Void. On the dark side we have the side of Revenge, captained up by Bulba. Saint Seiya returns on the Mirana. Morphling being picked up by Garter. Shadow Demon being played by Axel. And finally, Klunkka himself, the man with the swag, the man with the plan, and the man with all the hats, or so it seems like the genuine set actually coming out on him, along with the Leviathan Blade. The Klunkka definitely rocking the swag, rocking it like absolutely no one else could. 30 seconds to battle. I like his little monocle as well. Always interesting to see whatever cosmetics people do have on their favorite heroes. And judging from these, I'm guessing Squeal is definitely going to be more than proficient at whatever he's playing. Morphling as well. Got both the Immortals from the TIs this year and the previous one. Well, bottom lane, Benja is going to pick up a Pantheon for himself. And top lane will go the way of Faces Void as well. So somehow the Radiant side manages to pick both of those up. The Ward going out to try and block up the Scamp, but with Ryu not going for a Iron Talon, this Ward will be largely useless since Ryu can't really farm that up very easily. Maybe once, if he gets up that Iron Talon later on, that could be a for contestion, but looks like that's not the plan for him at all. Poor Man's Shield already being purchased up with the help of that Bounty Rune. Now Ryu gonna be disrupted up. Squeal throws out the Torrent, gonna be trying to get the trap in as well onto Ryu, but Ryu with the time walk away, he's one of the few heroes that can actually live through that damage early on. Of course, later on, if he's bursted down from full HP, then there's really nothing that you can be doing about that. They will need a little bit more damage to be able to do that, though. Maybe with the Morphling and a few levels in waveform, that could be an option, but until that happens, it's not going to be a possibility. Benjazz in that mid lane, farming up creeps left, right, and center, doing pretty well against the Mirana. Sitting even so far, not too surprising. It's very hard to prevent the Juggernaut from farming away. And now Ryo turning around, getting a few solid right clicks onto Squeal. Gotta be careful though, Axel is in the vicinity. He doesn't have a disruption for about 5 more seconds, and Squeal might end up going down over here. He has the movement speed advantage with his freshly purchased boots. Now Ryo, he's the one who's in trouble. Disruption could come out, but the torrent, it's already been thrown out. It's already been whiffed, and perhaps if the Kunkka had waited out a little bit longer, then Ryu would have ended up going down. But wait, hold that thought. Torrent goes out, will be caught up in it. Can use a time walk to negate a lot of that damage. Just using Tango's left, right, and center. Axel trying to juke it away. Axel, no boots, but he's got the movement speed that he needs. Right clicks going out. Still, Ryu just fighting away, staying alive for so long. Mid lane, also Mirana almost going down. And Saint Seiya is going to be taken down practically by this Phoenix who rotated in, but they need one more right click. They will get it. It's a 1-for-1 on the board. Radiant side for the casually rotating in Phoenix, just throwing out the laser beam. Mirana getting way too greedy. She had the Sov coming out to her on the corridor. Should have probably backed off, picked that up, and then come back into the lane once she noticed that the Phoenix was missing a force with the ward that they have plopped down. That doesn't give them all that much vision of the dire of the Radiant side jungle, which is a big disadvantage for them. This is also a very easy to deward ward, actually. I'm surprised that anyone actually puts down wards like that when they're trying to block that camp. It's a little bit surprising. A disconnect coming through onto Benjaz. Hopefully we'll be reconnecting pretty soon, but until that happens, we're gonna have to wait and stare at the pause screen telling us about the status of the game. Right now is Benjaz now boots on him own. That's all he has, and a disconnect to his name as well. Tinker though in that safe lane position, farming up pretty well for himself. 15-for-3, only trailing behind the Juggernaut, but once this creep wave goes his way, I imagine he should be able to pick up all those last hits with ease. Level 2 March of the Machine as well, and the safe lane Tinker should be able to go farm up any stacks that are ready for him. Juggernaut, of course, can also do that. He does have the level 2 spin. Once he gets at level 3, that makes it a lot easier to be able to spin down the creeps. The reduced mana cost is obviously also nice. And Saint Seiya now in that mid lane. Once again, after going down only level 3, almost level 4, but Juggernaut now edging closer and closer towards that level 5. Faceless Void as well, keeping TP in from Squeal on the top lane. Axel could get the disruption. That's exactly what he does. Squeal throws out the torrent, but a bit too late. He will actually fake it out. Now X coming through, and this is a great play from them. They're gonna be able to get all the damage. Ryu should end up going down, getting body blocked so well by Garter. One more right click and Squeal will be able to get that kill. Maybe if Morphling had been able to, the Morphling had gotten a bit careless and Squeal got the Ryu got one right click off, that would have been a different story. But so far so good for him. The other Ryu though, where is the other Ryu? I was sure he was playing actually. Okay, the other Ryu is the Tinker, so he's gone on the core position once again after his catastrophic performance in the previous game. Perhaps the lack of more tier 1 players is allowing him to do whatever he wants to. Of course, that was just one game, you can't really judge anyone. Could just have been having an off game. Bad Rider might not be his hero, and Tinker, so far from the farm that he's been acquiring, looks like it definitely is. Marches could go out of game. Just making sure that he can get those last hits and making sure he can get that tower damage out. Once he does get to that tower, maybe considers to body block the creeps up to delay their arrival at the tier 1 tower. Instead though, just going forward without any fear, uses the March of the Machines, even getting the boar last hit in the process. Boosting up his farm so well, but Fluff and Stuff is in the trees, so he can play this as aggressively as he wants to. Meanwhile, RWO showing himself in the mid lane. Mirana's gotta be careful. Saint Seiya could end up taking a fall. But Bulba on this bot lane, he's the one who's really in trouble. Fluff and Stuff gets the impale out, has the hex, will be able to use it if he wants to go on him, but ends up just saving mana. Wall coming through actually fails. Squeal, unfortunately, not getting that, but with the massive stack that they do have going for themselves, Morphling with a Waveform and a couple of Torrents can clear that out later on, be very, very happy with that. But bot lane, that's where the action's at. Phoenix rotating in from the back lines as well. The Shadow Demon does end up getting a kill on the Fluff and Stuff Lion, so it will be a 1-for-1 trade so far. And Axel is able to find that, and a lot of experience for himself. Level 4 on him now. Sitting comfortably on that bottom lane while he waits for the return of Bulba, who doesn't have money for a teleportation scroll for another few seconds. Axel does, however, push out the lane pretty handily, and now Bulba will be having a bit of an issue going into that lane, and he realizes that and goes into the jungle instead. Iron Talon not complete on him, along with the Tranquil Boots. Is farming away with the help of the level 2 aura as well, level 5 already. And they might just end up forfeiting this tier 1 tower by the time that the creeps get to it. Well, I suppose the creeps weren't really pulled properly, so it doesn't matter all that much. Kinks though. They Tinker though, sitting at 32 last hits and Soul Ring and 1100 gold. 6 minutes in, this could be a very fast boots of travel timing. But mid lane, that's where Rana's the one who's having issues. Fighting up against this Juggernaut. Just don't seem to be that many things he's able to do. The smoke coming through as well now. Shadow Demon probably to lead the way. Bulba's here as well, though. He has the roar there, trying to see if they can get a kill onto Ryu. Ryu's very, very low. If he's scouted out, then he will be dead to rights right there and then. But Ryu's backing up in time. The smoke gets popped. Ryu does not have the movement speed at mind. But look at the damage going out. If he gets a rocket out, then would be able to get that kill. The March of the Machine is not being respected enough, and Squeal's Torrent missing will mean that Ryu ends up going down. Ryu ends up living, and it's going to be Axel who's forced back to base. But the March of the Machine still just doing so much damage to him. Bulba on this bot lane. Dropping his Tranquil Boots, getting that maximum efficiency on the regeneration from those. On top lane, it's going to be Garter. In the meanwhile, just getting right-clicked up by Ryu. Got to be careful that he doesn't get bashed or the rotation coming through. Could end up getting a few kills, but looks like it's just going to be used to try and get those creeps. Garter gets quite a few for himself, though, and Squeal, with the Torrent, picks up one or two on his own, lonesome as well. Tinker now rotating in as well. Ryu, one more right-click goes out. Juggernaut will be able to get a kill onto Venge, onto Squeal, and Mirana gets a kill into Ryu in the meanwhile, going in through the back lines, gets a level 4 Starfall, the 500 damage nuke. Very, very significant. What? Bulba on this bot lane is the one who's taking damage as Morphling somehow manages to get the kill into Tinker. I'm already at that point where I'm too tired to cast and I'm missing kills. And if I, well, I think if we don't go above 10-15 viewers anytime soon, well, let's say by the next game, then I will probably just call it a night. Because no one really seems to be interested in today's games. Fluff and Stuff gets the Impale onto Bulba though. Bulba could end up going down, but the roar comes out onto Fluff and Stuff. The range creeps bring the damage they need, but the heal comes through from the Phoenix. Now Axel GD almost going down to Benjaz, who was spinning practically blind with the Mirana ultimate being used and no detection. He still manages to get off quite a bit of damage in this observe, the sentry ward not able to scout out the observer, so unfortunate for the Radiant side that they don't get that D ward. Carter in the meanwhile top lane just pushing in, and so far it just seems like a very even game all around. Ryu though, with the power, with the travels coming through soon, looking to change that. No bottle on him though, so these travels aren't as fast as I thought they would be, but unfortunate. We'll be able to go back to base and waddle his way down. Travels per chase stop now. Bulba though, level 7. Wants to get the kill onto Benjaz, but Benjaz just activates the phase boots, runs away. Like it's not any of his business being in that lane. And That might be the message that Bao Bao is trying to give to him, that no, it is none of your business being in this lane against me. Mid lane as well, this Mirana. I'm just getting out a couple more right clicks, the regeneration rune being scattered out by the Phoenix and RWO. Should have been able to get that up. Bulba in the meanwhile, just farming away in the Darkseid jungle. 1,000 gold on him, nothing on the courier, so he's not that farmed. 10 minutes in, doesn't really have that many components of the Necro Book, doesn't have the amount of farm that we're used to seeing come out on Beastmaster. He's actually sitting very far down, 5th on the net worth chart. Makes sense with the start that he did get, with the amount that he was zoned out by the Tinker. Saint Seiya returns in the mid lane, having gone for the Midas, accelerating on the farm charts. He's just right behind the Juggernaut. One more Midas usage should put him on top. Experience and gold alike. That was a mid lane matchup. It was not the Mirana versus the Tinker, it was the Mirana versus Benjaz. And Benjaz, 1500 gold on him, pace boots as well. Ryu is the one who's going in though. He's got the ultimate going out, and now Phoenix doing whatever he can, but the arrow comes out from Saint Seiya. Will be able to save Shadow Demon for now. Soulcatcher goes out in the back lines. The Mirana ultimate has been used. The torrent goes out. Ryu will end up going down to Carter, who does accumulate a killing spree for himself, saving the Shadow Demon in the process as well. Well played by them. Even the Chronosphere being wasted, and that might be their signal to go on to this top lane tier 1. No Chronosphere, no Phoenix Sunray. Well, Phoenix Sunray will be up pretty soon if it's not already. Yes, it is. But no Phoenix Teleportation. Not that they know that, but they will figure it out once they start going on to this top lane tier 1. And RWO, he knows this. He knows that he needs to be up on this top lane. Otherwise, they will end up forfeiting a tier 1 for free without even taking any of the experience to go side by side, hand in hand with what you expect from a falling tower. And Jazz in that mid lane, getting right clicked down by the Mirana. Saint Seiya returns, leaping herself forward, not using anything just quite yet, waiting for the roar to come out of Bulba. But Bulba not able to close the gap. Bulba not able to get in range and gets fogged, and unfortunately ends up having to retreat because of that. Now Ryu thinking of going in onto Garter with the Tinker, but Garter a bit too tanky, sitting at 1100 total HP right now. Very, very safe with whatever he had going for him. But now bot lane, fluff and stuff. 2200 gold now, the Blink Dagger purchased up. This is a good timing on him. If he went down just a little while earlier, this would have been a big kill for them to get, but now Fluff and Stuff is able to get him out. A little bit of damage, gets out the Hex, gets out the stun, gets the kill onto the Hawk, but loses that gold immediately, of course. Having purchased up the Blink Dagger, gonna be more than worth it for him, but now this Courier might be in jeopardy if Saint Seiya chooses to leap forward for it, get a couple of right clicks out onto it, but does end up staying in check, does end up staying back. And Carter, Lincoln Sphere on its way. Gonna make it hard for the Lion to initiate onto the Morphling. Despite the Blink Dagger up and ready, he will need to use the mana leak to try and break that Lincoln's earlier on. And of course, that's not really the ideal situation. Axel in the meanwhile, maximizing up the Shadow Poison, trying to get as much damage through as humanly possible from it. As soon arrow goes out, catches onto Siege Creep though, not onto the Tinker. If this was one of the previous patches where the arrow went through the Siege Creep, that would have probably ended up being a very stunned Tinker for just a few seconds. No gank up onto the Lion. Blink Dagger on him as well, just wants to be showcasing that. Ryu with the Chronosphere ready. Hopefully they can be more effective with it this time than they were in the previous gank attempt that they did have. Now Benjaz going up, Link forward, Hex onto Squeal, the Omni Slash as well. Kunkka ends up going down. Garter TP in towards that mid lane tier 2. Bulba gets a roar, the stun gets tanked by the spin. And Arrow will not be able to accomplish anything at all so far. 2-for-1 maybe, maybe a little bit more as Benjaz getting his healing ward killed up, getting the soul catcher going out on him. No Chronosphere used just quite yet, and fighting 5 versus 4, practically 5 versus 2 with the Faceless Void also being useless, just not able to get a good Chronosphere off, just not sure which targets to be able to Chronosphere into Oblivion. Which targets can he even really kill? And now suddenly, speaking of targets to kill, Ryu dodges both Ship and Torrent, and Squeal having a moment of rare. That was a very well-timed arrow though, I've got to say. Squeal, on the other hand, a bit off with his timing, but Mirana, pretty solid, pretty solid. Dire's bottom tower is under attack. RWO in the meanwhile, throwing out the laser beam, is doing a little bit of damage onto the Mirana. Blink power from Fluffins up, has the Finger of Death, will probably choose to use it. Yes, he will. Icarus die powered into the Phoenix Egg. RWO bringing himself back to life, bringing himself and his cooldowns and his mana pool, and of course his health back up to full. Because of that, now Boba mid lane, just right clicking away onto Benjaz. Benjaz doesn't care all that much though. The Purge though, that's what he's going to be caring about for true purposes. And the Necrobook is going to be burning out his mana. The Roar goes out onto Benjaz. Benjaz will end up going down. The Ghost Ship gets thrown out, not catching anyone, but does give them all a lot more tankability. Kunkka feeling like he can face the world at this point. It looks like this might be the last game of the evening, man. Well, I guess I go to sleep for an hour and wake up again if push comes to shove. I should probably do that now, to be honest. Go to sleep and wake up again, but I would like to finish casting this game, man, because I have started it and there are a few people watching, and even if you are just 3 viewers, I do value every single one of you. The arrow going out, catching nothing but air, and by that I do not mean it was a swish swat. That's nothing but net. Garter waveforming forward, getting a few of those last hits a little bit more quickly, making sure that he does have that going for him. The Roche Pit is being pinged out. They want to try and sneak this away, revenge. They're already in this lead, and getting a Roshan for a tier 1 trade is more than satisfying for them, or at least so Boba thinks so. The illusion going to be used to tank up the Roshan. Of course, you need to remember that if you don't right click the illusion, then Roshan should be able to hit that illusion without killing it instantaneously, especially with the amount of tankability that Morphling Replicate illusions do have. Even the Necrobook being used up, it is only a Necrobook 2 though, so not all that effective, not all that much damage, and not all that much regret about using it just quite yet. Now the thing's coming out, they've got to be careful. Smoked up is Fluff and Stuff, he has that Blink Dagger. Wants to show it off one more time. And they do scout out Boba. He will pop the smoke. Blink forward from Fluff and Stuff as possible, but doesn't choose to do so just quite yet. Fluff and Stuff, blink forward. No detection on him though. And RWO will end up falling down without even being able to get that ultimate off. And now Haste Rune up onto Boba, onto Saint Seiya. Hex or no Hex, that won't be helping you out. Saint Seiya gets up that kill. Mid tower goes the way of Morphling. Garter just farming away, more than content with what he's got going for him. Waveform at the ready, could choose to go forward and try and harass out Ryu just a little bit, but with a time walk available as well, this doesn't seem like an effective strategy moving into this game. I have Instagram notifications. Woohoo! No idea who this guy is, but now playing forward from Thuff and Slap, he gets the hex this time. Bulba will be disrupted up to an axle. He's going to be the only one caught up in that. A nice little boat combination going out onto Ryu. Ryu's taking a lot of damage, but he is able to mitigate a lot of it. Goes forward, fakes out the Chronosphere. Will not be able to get it off onto any of the good targets, and Axel unsuccessfully trying to deny himself. In the meanwhile, three people do go down in mid lane. All in all, Mirana still just farming away. Blink Dagger, Midas, Aghanim's. What does this man not have? The only thing he really doesn't have is a slot in the top two, a slot in the top of the net worth charts. Morphling has somehow managed to stay ahead of this Mirana and farm now. X back into the torrent. Saint Seiya trying his best to get a kill on the Ben Jazz, will take a lot of damage for it, but ends up being successful. Radiant's bottom tower is under Garter and Ben Jazz both calling out the GG, most likely not a real GG though. Now Garter, not very much time left on that replicate. Well, I say that, but 35 seconds is quite a bit of time. Top lane though, Bulba gonna be able to get that roar onto Ryu. Ryu is just getting sloppy, man. He's just got that safe lane, didn't do anything with it. Previous game, got that mid lane, didn't do anything with it. And Ryu just seems to be one of those people who you need to give that support position to. Because he's definitely got the knowledge, don't get me wrong. He's definitely got the raw skill and raw talent, but he just hasn't refined it to the extent that the rest of these players have. You can only get so far with just the raw, unrefined everything, really. Ben Jazz spamming out the GG. Going for what could be a blade mail. A bit of a questionable pick, to be honest, if he does go for the blade mail. Not that much damage coming out from any one of these folks. I suppose with the E-Blade now up onto the Morphling, it's a possibility, but Garter, no power shreds on him either. I don't really like this build since the Morphling is very, very slow. Even the Tranquil Boots aren't that bad on the Morphling. Simply by virtue of the movement speed just being so very useful. The travel is also part of why people go for that now. Arrow being cut out by the Phoenix. Interesting Chronosphere going out. Almost allows the Mirana to escape, but now Ryu, he's the one who's going to end up going down as the roar does go out onto him. Garter getting a double kill beyond godlike speed. Tensu and Fortis hasn't really been wrecked so far. GG is called from the Radiant side, and this time it is RWO calling it. Will be the end of the game, and okay guys, I'm going to go to sleep for like half an hour to an hour. Then I'm going to come back and cast some more. Hopefully we'll have some more viewers then as well. So